Hello, I'm Ismail Mejia. I'm going to talk with you about Nexmark. That is a suite, a benchmark suite for Apache Beam. I'm a software engineer at Talent. I work mostly in open source projects. I contribute to the Apache Software Foundation projects, and I'm a committer in Apache Beam. So first, I want to talk a little bit about my company. We do integration software solution that is mostly focused now in big data and real-time systems. We are open source. You can download the product and play with it. And we also have an enterprise solution that includes most of these compliance things for enterprises. Right now, we have a new suite of products that is based on Apache Beam. So that's the reason why we are involved in this community and this kind of work. We are actively hiring at this moment. So if somebody wants to join me afterwards and is interested, sadly we don't have an office for software engineers in Berlin, but we have one office in Bonn, and also the other offices are in France, so you're welcome. So let's go with the agenda. We're going to talk first about the big data benchmarking, the state of the art. We're going to introduce Nexmark, that is a research project, a research paper from the beginning of the 2000s. And we are going to talk about the implementation of Nexmark on Beam, and see some details about the Beam model and how we use them to implement Nexmark. And finally, we are going to look how we use Nexmark, how can we execute it, and some discussion about benchmarking. And finally, we are going to discuss the current status of the project and the future work. Notice that this is an ongoing process, so this is the way we're working. So, big data benchmarking, what do we have here? First, let's just discuss about benchmarking in general. Why do we benchmark? We benchmark because we want to measure the performance of our systems. We want to know how long sometimes take and if it's good or is expected. And also we measure the correctness of our results. So we see if what we wanted to compute is well. And how do we do this? We do this with four basic steps that almost every benchmark does. First, we generate data. If this is done from an abstract source, we call this synthetic data for the benchmark. We compute this data. We measure the performance of the operations we do. And finally, we validate that the results are correct. This seems pretty obvious, but this is the way all the benchmarks work. And we have different types of benchmarks. This classification is totally arbitrary and is mine. We have micro benchmarks that mostly measure one specific point of performance. For example, I want to measure how much cost to serialize data in my job. We have also functional benchmarks, like for example, when we want to measure a join between two tables, for example, or two distributed file systems. We have also business case-oriented benchmarks. These are more like the TPCDS suite, where we take, for example, a business case, for example, a decision system, and with this decision system, we ask some questions that became queries. And with these queries, we create a suite of tests that validate our benchmark. And finally, we have more recently data mining and machine learning jobs that we use, for example, to train a model and see if the systems are executed in the correct way and with performance this. So what are the issues with benchmarks for big data? First, there is not a de facto suite for benchmarking. We have several proposals for benchmarks for big data. But I think as we don't have like a common model or a common API, it's really difficult to have an de facto suite. So this is correlated to the second point, as you see. And also, since historically big data comes from the Hadoop family, most of the things are really strongly tied with the Hadoop infrastructure. So some of these benchmarks are really going towards Hadoop. And some of these also mix the benchmarking of the storage and the processing also in the Hadoop world. As you know, HDFS is the storage, YARN is how we process things. So these are really tightly coupled. They're not tightly coupled in Hadoop. You can easily work with those separated, but in the benchmark, sometimes they are mixed. And finally, and more important for this talk, we don't have a lot of work in benchmark for streaming semantics. So this is also a gap in the research at this moment. So what is the state of the art looking concretely at the benchmarks? First, we have the TeraSoft benchmark, that is this annual competition of how we can sort data faster, and it's probably the most well-known benchmark in the big data world. First, there is the, then there is the TPCX HS family of benchmarks, for example, for Hadoop distribution. This one is more to measure the quality of your installation of Hadoop or the distributions you are using. Then there is the TPCDS family on Spark. This was created by Databricks, but this mostly measures the quality of the SQL implementation, how complete it is. Then there is all these Berkeley big data benchmarks who are running SQL-like systems like Hive or Redshift. And finally, we have the Intel benchmarks like HiBench and BigBench. HiBench is one really interesting one because it covers all these type of benchmarks that I mentioned before, like micro benchmark, functional benchmark. They also have a use case, and even they have also a streaming case. They have tumble windows in their benchmark, which is a great improvement. Finally, 2 years ago, one and a half, Yahoo published a benchmark for streaming. They implemented one case in different systems, and they evaluated how they performed. This produced some kind of discussion in the community about if the implementation for every system was correct. So this is where we arrive to NextMark.
So, what is NextMark? NextMark is a research paper that was published in the 2000s, beginning. There was a lot of research on continuous streaming systems, not big data, but just continuous. And it was never published, it's just a draft. But it proposes a suite, like the PPC suite, but with continuous queries. And the business case is quite easy, quite nice to present. It's just an auction system where people are going to sell something, and there are bidders who want to buy these items. It's quite interesting. It's not really many queries of with the dimension of time. For example, if you want to know what was the auction, who most price in the last hour, bang, you can really apply the time dimension. It's short and nice to explain. And this was the reason why it was taken and implemented by the Google guys on Dataflow. So this was taken on Dataflow to create a sort of test case, I mean, an integration case. And it was enriched. These were 8 queries in the initial version. The Google guys added 5 extra queries. And it was used as an integration test scenario inside of Google Dataflow. This is Google Dataflow, but we are in Apache Beam now. So we are going to talk a little bit about Beam and this transition. So what is the deal with Beam? Actually, if you think about it, in the big data world, there were like two big families. All the things that Google was doing and was publishing research papers, like Bigtable, like Colossus, like Spanner, and all the things that were done in the Apache world, like the HBase, Keeper, some of them were implementation of those systems, but also there were some original and new ideas in this space too. But in the end, Apache Beam is like a nice thing because it's the point where both of them connect. Because Google released the SDK and some running implementation to the Apache Software Foundation, and from there, all the other communities took around to create different supports for it, like a Spark runner, a thing to run Flink, etc. So we're going to see. But in the base, what is the goal of Beam? The goal of Beam is to have a unified programming model with two characteristics. It should be efficient and it should be portable. So this is like the design constraints of Beam to create data processing pipelines. And more concretely, we have an SDK for different languages. We have an SDK for Java and Python at this moment. There is a work in progress for the Go one. And on top of this, we are starting to build libraries and DSLs. The Spotify guys created Shio, that is something like a link, like in the Microsoft Link sense, API, also like Spark or like Scouting, for example. And also we have an SQL that is also a work in progress at this moment. Also there are IOs, as we call them, but those are connectors to different data stores. So you want to connect to Kafka, you want to connect to Cassandra, or we have all of these things, obviously, that parallelize well, and that have dynamic resharding, that is another advanced point of Beam. And finally, and most interesting is the runners. We can, with just the same code, we can run the code in both Google Dataflow, Apache Spark, Apache Flink, Apache Apex. So all of these are the current runners. In the top line are the ones who are already mastered and are part of the project. On the bottom line are the work in progress. As you can see, we are rapidly covering all the most of the stream engines in Apache. So this is quite nice. Finally, how does Beam does this magic? So Beam makes a clear distinction between event time and processing time, and every object that you process in Beam is timestamped, and this timestamp is the moment when the event happens. For example, if you're on your telephone and you're doing an action, this is the event time. But the processing time is the time when all these events arrive to the server and are processed. So why do we do this distinction? Because if we want to have appropriate semantics for streaming, we can use event time and we can have consistency. So more in detail, what is the real problem? The real problem is that we can in streaming we have an infinite amount of data, and we cannot know when it's the end. So we have to find a way to define some kind of barriers, and this kind of code windows that are used to split this data into those. Mm-hmm. So the idea here is that we move based on the event time into the infinite chunks. So, but this still, for example, in this diagram, we are summing the numbers, and when we arrive to the top, the result is calculated, and we divide it in time, but we have to wait still to produce the result. So there are some cases when we want to have results in advance, or we want to take late results into account, and this is the when question in the Beam model, and this is based on the concept of watermark. Watermark is this line that is advancing there, and it defines that it's a measure of progress. It's like the system is telling you, okay, in this moment, I don't think there is going to arrive more data. It's okay, the data is enough. However, as you can see, we have an outlier here. This is an event that arrives late in time, and we have to deal with those because in distributed systems, those happen all the time. So this is the model.
How do we do this? We do this with the concept of a pipeline. A pipeline is a set of steps when we take data from a source, and this is our input P collection. Parallel collection is the original base of this. For example, we read from Kafka, we window the events per minute, then we count and we write the results into HDFS. This is a really simple example of how things work. Notice that most of the steps in the middle are just transforms. It's like really functional composition. And well, this is a linear example, but don't think that every example is linear. Every DAG that you can express works. So how do we do this? We have three families of transforms. We have the map, like the map reduced. We cover the element-wise transforms are the map. And we have parallel do, that is like a high-level map, let's say, like for those of you who know Flink, this is like rich function in Flink. And with this, we can play with multiple inputs, we can play with multiple outputs, we can play with time also. But we have more simple transforms like map and flat map, the classical ones, and transforms to play with key values also. And we have the grouping transforms, who allows us to group by key and co-group by key, for example, when we need to join data. And also the reduced transforms, like in MapReduce, that we call combiners in Beam, and classical associative combiners like sum and count. And finally, and more interesting, is the window and triggers family of transforms. And these are the ones who allow us to play with time. With this, we can define different kind of windows that we're going to detail later on, and different kind of triggers that also I explain in detail later on. So what is the story of NextMar on Bing? As I said, the Google guys implemented this, did a pull request into the Apache repository in version 0.2, and then the guy who was behind this quit the company, and then the pull request was stale for months and months and months. But some of us in the community viewed the value of this and took it into a better form. So we refactor all of this into the stable version of Beam. And I forgot to say this, Beam is like 3 weeks ago, released its first stable release. So we have an API that is not going to change arbitrarily now. So we are, all of this is to get in more enterprise ready. And we also make the code generic and test it with all the runners, because in the Dataflow days, they only tested with Dataflow and just a little bit with Flink. We also evolved the queries to use the new APIs of Beam. Beam has introduced new APIs after being in Apache, like the state and timer APIs. And we also validated the queries with all the runners to find errors and things around and bug the people who produce these errors. So, okay, so what is the advantage of using Beam for this? Is that we have a rich model. And this is interesting because the Dataflow model is, to my knowledge, the most complete model for semantics for streaming systems in big data. We also have the advantage to not have to rewrite the code if we want to test in batch on streaming. We can use the same code. We have all the support of the multiple runners, and we have metrics that come with Beam also. So we can have counters, histograms, and these kind of things for our benchmark. So how did we implement this? Nexmar is quite simple. We have just a launcher for the execution of these queries. Let's say queries. You will use query and pipeline, the same word here. And we have an object generator who is going to produce events like new auctions, new bids, new persons in the systems. And this generator is going to produce data depending on the configuration in batch and streaming mode. And we are going to measure this with metrics. And every query does a different kind of transformation. So this is, for example, a set of the interesting queries in the suite who answered a really clear business question. And on the side are the Beam concepts that we are evaluating here. Notice that some of these are written to answer the question. Some of these are written to test in a way that we can test also the boundaries of Beam. I mean, for example, we can do some things in a way, but sometimes we decide to do it in a different way just to prove a case. These queries, in general, follow a pattern. The pattern is we have a collection of events, P collection, parallel collection in this case, and we filter the objects that interest us. For example, if I measure in auctions, I just extract the auctions, and then I do all the logic, the filter count, group by key, windows, co-group by keys, all this kind of stuff. And finally, we apply this and produce an output collection. So again, nothing really complex, I think. So the thing that changes most in all of these queries is the step three. And we are going to see that with this step three, we can explore certain key points of the Beam implementation. So first one, we discussed before that we needed to divide data into event time windows. Here we use five different queries that use different type of windows. More interesting type of windows like sessions, for example, that measure gaps of inactivity. I mean, this is like in a web server when you do actions, and we are putting all these actions that don't have a certain gap into the same group. So sometimes we need results in advance. And for example, in this case, in the case of query 11, we just count data. When we have 20 results, we assume that we have enough results to produce an aggregation, and we do this. And we can do this using the figure of triggers in Beam. And in Beam, the triggers can be data-driven, but also time-driven. And the default is time-driven, and is when the window is complete, and this is indicated by the watermark. But we also can create triggers in processing time. This is more tricky because we wanted to test some evaluation in processing time. And in this case, when we receive an event of a person, we create a duration, and this is like a sort of session for this data. This is a different key point that we addressed. Also, we have how can we temporarily group events? And this is an interesting case because here we have an auction that is open, but we have different bids that arrive into the systems. For example, bid one was a bid from the previous auction, so we ignore it. But then bid two is in the time space of the auction, so we put it in the auction window. So we can recreate these windows with functions. As these window functions help us to do that. And finally, how can we deal with the fact that sometimes events arrive in a different order? And to do this, we created, we use the state and the timer APIs of Beam. And what we do is, for example, in this case, imagine that we have to answer the question, which people did what, which auctions. So if an auction arrives and the person has not arrived, we have to wait until the person arrives. So we store this in the state. And we do this with both events. When we complete, we create a timer that is going to give a duration to this data before expiring it. So this is another key point, that the kind of things that we can address with Beam in this benchmark. So to conclude about the queries, we cover most of the Beam API. We illustrate also working on processing time. And as you can see from the descriptions, they're really user-oriented cases. I mean, this is not so invented as a case. And in particular, the thing I love the most is that we have really explored the capabilities of the runners, until which points we can go today. We have in Beam this thing we call the capability matrix, that is the representation of all the subparts of the Beam model that every runner supports. But this is a real test. I mean, Beam authors, runner authors can say, well, we support this. But if in the practice, we have to test this. So this, in the end, was a win-win story for us, because we support all this streaming, advanced streaming semantics. We do regression tests on the runners. We can perform we can compare the performance of two versions of the same engine or two versions of the same runner, and even among runners. But this is delicate. We will discuss this in a moment. We can use this also as integration tests, for example, to test how the SDK works with the runners, how the runners with the engines. And as I said, this validates the capability matrix. So how do you use Nexmark? But before this, let's discuss about neutral benchmarking, because this is a delicate subject. Actually, as I said, the different runners have different levels of support on Beam. So some of the things we can just compare, because they are not supported yet. They are getting better, but some are not yet. Also, every one of these different systems, Spark, Dataflow, Apex, Flink, have different strengths. Some of those were designed more to be batch-oriented. Some of those were designed to be more streaming-oriented, even sub-second response times-oriented. Others were designed more to care about auto-scaling and being more robust. So all these things make that we cannot easily compare them, because they have different priorities. And as you know, also, all these systems have many knobs that you can turn. And if you don't put the actual appropriate options, probably you won't get a decent result. So there is always going to be a contentious area of comparing this. And finally, well, benchmarking in a distributed environment also can be inconsistent. If you run this, for example, with 100 machines, and then five of these machines' workers broke, well, the result is not going to be the same, because you have to resign the work. So it's not so easy. So how we execute Nexmark, and this is a little bit of code, but just to show you that the promise of write the same code and run it in different runners works. As you see, we use a profile for every runner, and we just pass which runner we want to run, and that's it. It works like that. But we also can define other options. For example, if this runs in a streaming mode, I mean, if it's an unbounded source, or it is not, if it's a batch source, like in this case. And also, if you want to use the submission system of the way to submit in your system, like Spark Summit, you can also do it. And you can, a part of this, you have options to configure many, many small details in the benchmark. You can change the number of events generated, the number of generator threads. You can also define some initial rates. You can define concurrent actions. You can define the size of the windows. And you can define proportions also, like how many hot auctions I will have in this case, how many hot bidders. And finally, we can also create artificial CPU load on I/O load, just to make it more realistic. This is, for example, a case of the output of an execution of the benchmark. We have just the execution time and the throughput of events per second, the results of each query. This is in Spark Runner in batch mode. This is in Spark Runner in streaming mode. And as you can see here, there are two things that are curious. As you see, there are results that are in zero. This is because these parts are not supported yet by the Spark Runner. This is the state and timer API that we use for these queries, and they're not, we don't have results for those. And also we have this outlier, this number 6. This is not a super big data execution. This is what you see in my machine to show you. But we have still an outlier here. And I don't know yet what it is. I have to investigate more deeply why this query 6 is taking so long. In particular, because there is another query that is based on the same logic and is almost the same, is faster, so something weird. We use also this to compare different versions of the Spark engine with the Spark Runner. For example, in here we compare version 1.6 with 1.6.3, 1.6.0, sorry. And as you can see, there are some slight improvements in some of the queries and in others, no. We cannot conclude a lot with this, but this can be a tool in the future. For example, if you want to migrate your infrastructure, you can measure these kind of things and see how it evolves. So what's the current status and what's the future work for us? This is the execution matrix. We have the 13 queries and the current support for all the runners that is quite good now. You can see mentioned there, these are the numbers of the issues in Jira and Apache, so, or the things that we are missing to complete the whole matrix. And as you can notice, one thing here is that we don't have data flow in the system, which is curious because we should. But well, I had my open source hat on and I prioritized the testing in the Apache runners. But we are going to add data flow in the next weeks and just discuss with the Google guys in order to do this. And we work in this in a fork of Beam. We created around 50 issues and we solved most of them. And then we passed this upstream, all the issues that were part of core Beam. And we all of these are referenced by the Beam's 160 Jira. Good thing is that we opened around 17 issues and 7 were already closed. We did the PR for this 3 weeks or 4 weeks ago, and it has already passed the review process and will be merged soon. I hope it will be out of Beam 2.1. So this is the current state. What is the future work here? Well, we have to still fix some of the issues. We have to integrate this in, make this part of the integration test on Beam. And this is a project that we have. The goal is that we're going to create a Kubernetes cluster that is going to create sub-clusters, for example, a Spark cluster, a Flink cluster, and we're going to run this suite in each of these clusters to see how things perform, and a Hadoop cluster also. So, and this will be done probably once per day or something like that to ensure that we don't have regressions with all of these runners. And also, we will include the new runners that arrive, for example, Gear Pump, that is an Intel one, or the ones on Storm also. And in the future, we also expect to have the SQL support here. I mean, some of these queries, not all, can be expressed like SQL queries, so why we were going to be so complicated, we can just write the SQL and use them. And this will be done once the calcite-based SQL gets into Beam. So this is a call for contributions. If you are interested in this area, if you want to take this and try it in your enterprise, in your clusters, or if you notice something not working, come and open issues or discuss or contribute. Of course, we are improving the documentation of this because it's not that perfect now. And also, this is a call to contribute and participate in Beam. I think Beam is a perfect moment to jump in if you're interested in this, because we arrived to the stable point. There are no hardcore refactorings happening, so your code will work in the future. This is a guarantee we do as a community. And also, this is the moment when we are starting to build more libraries on top of Beam. So if you are interested in this area and you want to contribute something, I don't know, the complex event processing library or something for machine learning, this is perfect. This is the right moment to jump in. And also, if you notice that there is not a connector for any of the databases you use or something like that, also, these are welcome contributions. Finally, I want to greet most of the people who work in this. There's a lot of people. All the fixes, where I was nagging people for months. So I want to openly thank all of those who were helpful. And well, this is a team effort, actually. So if you want to go further, you can follow these references. I will share the slides after the presentation. And I think that's it, so thank you. And if you have questions, I have BIM stickers, I forgot also. Yes, that's it.
Cool, thank you. We have time for questions, so.
Actually, quite a simple one. In your execution overview, you had Flink and Apex and a few others, but also a runner called Direct. What is that?
Ah, yeah, sorry, I didn't talk about that. Yes, Beam has, I'm just going to bring back there. This one. Yes, actually, if you want to try Beam in your machine, we have a runner that is a direct runner that runs locally. This is not a distributed runner. However, it's really nice to use, really important to use it, because it really enforces the semantics of Beam. It forces serialization, encodability, all these kind of details that if it works there, it will probably work in the distributed system. So this is like the first step when you develop on Beam. And we measure the performance of this because we measure this also locally. And one interesting point, I mean, I said that I shouldn't compare those, but the direct runner is not the fastest one. It's not, because it's not, it's the priority. The priority is conformance with the Beam model.
So that's the one you use if you were doing a debug session?
Exactly. When you develop on Beam, you start with the direct runner.
Cool. Yes. Questions?
Yeah, thanks for the talk. Very interesting. I'm curious, I guess there's a reason you didn't tell us anything about this, but still, is there any information you're willing to share as far as performance across different frameworks is concerned?
Okay, I saw this question coming. Yes, of course. Well, I have to be honest, I have to play politically correct here because I'm in the middle of all these runners, so I cannot give a lot of this information. However, we plan to publish this in the Beam community openly. I mean, all these integration tests are going to be public, accessible. We are not lying if this is what the tests run, and then they will be improved in time. But no, for the moment, I don't give more details.
Other questions? There we go.
Something that's kind of related, but maybe not so politically tricky in some sense. Did you ever try to compare Nextmark runs on, let's say, Beam on a system versus on the system directly in order to get a feeling how much overhead does the Beam abstraction on top of a system add?
This is also an interesting question. I think we need in the future to have something like Nextmark implemented in one of those systems to do a better comparison of this. In particular, we have reports that the translation on Spark is not as good as the native Spark, but we cannot prove this. So this would be a way to prove this. But yeah, this is a good point. Well.
We still have time for questions. If there are still questions, okay. So,
okay.
I think that was it. Thank you, Ismael, for the talk. Another round of applause.